was working. Welcome to New Directions for Women, a program of the Morris County chapter of the National Organization for Women. I keep forgetting to say it, New Jersey, Morris County, New Jersey. My name is Rebecca Lubetkin, and I and the entire crew here are all members of this chapter of the National Organization for Women. And we're all volunteers. This is something that we do in addition to our day jobs. Everybody, the producer, the director, graphics, audio, all doing this as a labor of love for 16 years. So we're aging together. We have a good show for you today. We're going to talk about early puberty in girls. Is it really happening? Is it a problem if it is happening? And if so, what are its ramifications? What's the impact on the girls psychologically and developmentally, and what is the impact on their future lives, on their families, and on our society in general? And to help us sort it out, we are fortunate to have one of the nationally known experts, Dr. Lawrence Silverman, a New Jersey native. Dr. Silverman is a board-certified pediatric endocrinologist. He is a graduate of Columbia and of the University of Medicine and Dentistry of New Jersey. He's currently affiliated with Goryeb Children's Hospital, which is part of the Atlantic Health System, and has an academic appointment with the University of Medicine and Dentistry of New Jersey. And I want to welcome you and thank you for coming, Dr. Silverman.
Thanks for having me.
Delighted. And I'd like to start by asking you to tell us a little bit about yourself. I always ask this question because I find interesting relationships between people's formative years and what they choose as either their passion or their life's work.
Well, I'm a Jersey boy, and I grew up where Routes 9 and Route 70 intersect, so I guess I'm a Springsteen fan. And if you ask my parents, they would tell you I knew I wanted to be a doctor probably since I was 10.
Really?
And
And a pediatrician?
Well, I used to be the locker boy at a beach in Point Pleasant, and was also the chief babysitter for a while, I guess. So I always liked kids, and if you think about why you go into medicine, you want people to get better, and kids don't get sick, but they certainly get better.
And if it's more positive than a lot of others.
It is, and if you think about endocrinology, we give you back a hormone that your body isn't otherwise making, and it is as if you don't have a disease. So in some ways, it's a perfect form of medicine to be in.
Except if you get your tonsils out, you feel good when you go in and you feel bad when you come out.
Well, you don't want me anywhere near an operating room, believe me.
Okay. We hear a lot about how girls are experiencing puberty at an early age, earlier age, we're told. And is this true?
Well, I think there's two answers to that. It appears from the data and some studies that come out that girls are having breast development a little bit earlier than perhaps they did a couple hundred years ago, and maybe a slight bit earlier than they did 30 or 40 years ago.
So what would be the average, let's say, breast buds?
The average for menses, for first menstrual cycle, is about 12 years and 3 months. And working backwards, the average girl is going to have her first breast development about 2 years earlier than that. So the average is still going to be between 10 and 10 and a half. But what's changed is that we've sort of redefined the early point of normal. The textbooks, have said that breast development as the first sign of puberty at 8 in a girl, and the first sign of puberty in boys at 9. And some studies have come out over the last 10 or 15 years that suggest that absolutely normal children may be showing the first signs of puberty perhaps a year and a half earlier than that.
Means 7?
It's possible. There was a large study called Pediatric Research in the Office Setting that came out in 1995. And while there were concerns with the study and it wasn't perfectly done, the suggestion was that, most Caucasian girls are having their first breast development at 8, but African-American girls, perhaps as early as 7 or even 6 in girls who are normal, who don't have an underlying disease.
You said most?
Most are still having it, in that 10 range. Mm-hmm. But some normal girls, again, may have breast development earlier than 8 years of age.
So if a parent brings in a child at that age, you're not alarmed?
You're not alarmed, but it's still something that should be considered and discussed because, while it's unlikely there's an underlying abnormal medical reason for this to be happening, you know, for a girl to be experiencing her first signs of puberty in second or third grade and making her much different from her peers, you know, may be distressing to her. Certainly it's frequently distressing to the parents as well.
Well, then I'd like to ask you whether anything can be done about it and whether anything should be done about it.
Sure. Well, certainly, you know, as an endocrinologist, we'll see kids who are in puberty at, say, 3 or 4 years of age who have an underlying abnormal reason for that to be occurring. And in those children, it's absolutely appropriate to turn off puberty.
And what does that mean, turn off?
Well, puberty is triggered by the brain, which controls the pituitary, the master gland, and then that controls the ovaries in girls and the testes in boys, and the production of sex hormones from the ovaries or the testes lead to pubertal development. To see the signs that we're seeing, breast development, growth spurt in girls, virilization, growth spurt in boys. There are medications that have been available since the late 80s that basically shut down the way the brain speaks to the pituitary, The pituitary speaks to the ovaries or testes, and giving those medications on a consistent basis can turn puberty off. And when those medications are stopped or removed, then puberty turns back on and the children will progress through puberty. And these medications are medications that people are familiar with. One's called Lupron. Main in usage is actually in men with prostate cancer. It's used in women with endometriosis. It's used in women with breast cancer as well. So these medications were first developed for use in adults, but very quickly put into use in children. And there's, you know, good relatively long-term safety data in using them, as well as effectiveness data, efficacy data.
So you would think possibly of doing that in a child who's, say, younger than 8?
Sure. I mean, if we're seeing a girl under 8, and sometimes over 8, who's in, you know, early puberty, whose progression through puberty is perhaps quick, whose presence in puberty, you know, what the girl's seeing is distressing to her, is making her feel uncomfortable in relationship to her peers or her parents have those concerns, you know, then certainly we'll talk about whether or not to turn puberty off in those girls.
I think about the daughter of a friend of ours who's an adult now, but she was adopted, so the parents knew nothing about her genetic background. Mm-hmm. And at 8, she got her period for the first time. And she was very upset. I think she was in the third grade.
Sure.
Having to carry a pocketbook to school in order to carry sanitary napkins and so on was very difficult for her. Plus, they hadn't prepared her in any way because they had no idea that this was going to happen. And so it was very difficult, and it separated her from her peers. And the reason I mentioned the story is that she got married recently. The parents had put a new deck on their house in order to have the reception mm-hmm. on this gorgeous new deck. And as the caterers are putting the dishes out, the china out, the deck collapses. And this is like 2 hours before the wedding ceremony, which was going to be in the garden. And her mother was very upset and said, "Oh, I'm so sorry, Lori. I'm just so sorry." And Lori said, "That's okay, Mom. Nothing good has ever happened to me." And the mother immediately thought back to that early puberty, thinking that, you know, it was very, very traumatic to her. So I don't know whether it is to most 8-year-olds, but
well,
it made a huge difference.
You know, I think like many other things in medicine and life, you have to have the perspective of, you know, the individual and what's going on. You know, if an 8-year-old girl looks like she's 12, you know, she may, you know, feel like she's being treated like she's 16 or 20, and that's certainly something you don't want to happen. But, you know, an 8-year-old girl can be in third grade and she can be in fourth grade, depending on when her birthday is and when she started school. And if her mom, you know, had her period at 9 or 10 and felt comfortable with it, and her aunts did and her cousins did, you know, then that's the family's perspective.
Yeah.
But, you know, if mom had her period at 12 and a half and this girl's going to have her period at 9, you know, and maybe is in the second grade when she's having some development, you know, she may feel quite uncomfortable. And certainly one of the things that's important for us to do in the office is to, you know, make sure that the kids, you know, not necessarily in the office, but afterwards feel comfortable talking to their parents about what they feel. Because in the, you know, the 40 minutes that I'm spending with a patient, I'm not going to figure that all out.
Right.
Because I don't know them. But you can get a feel about whether a child is, you know, self-confident and mature, or whether they're, you know, a kid, as certainly they should be. Mm. And we, you know, I've had girls who've come in and, you know, everything's fine. And then they go home and the mom calls me the next day and said, you know, she finally told me everything isn't fine and she is uncomfortable about what's going on with her body compared to her peers. And maybe we should talk about doing something.
And then you do it because you don't see much risk in terms of a downside.
No, the long term, you know, when you think about treating children and turning puberty off, the first thing, side effect you always would be worried about is that things will turn back on again when the medication is discontinued. And indeed, soon after the first studies using these medications in kids were published, the follow-up studies were out very early showing that puberty does resume. And certainly there's very good animal data that would suggest that occurred, but this has been published data, you know, on 15 years now. And the longer term data that we have suggests that the girls do go on to have menses. They have all the markers of ovulation that you would expect. Unfortunately, at least in the United States, we're not set up to track these kids through a national health record childbearing, but there are plenty of reports of them going on to have normal pregnancies as well. You know, these girls, again, you know, if you think about somebody who was treated, you know, in the late 80s at the age of 8, you know, she would just be in a childbearing age now. But we have no reason to think that there would be problems.
But that medication that you're talking about, that doesn't include human growth hormone then?
No, growth hormone is separate in the mix.
And is there a relationship between early puberty and height?
Okay. So certainly the easy way to think about that is rough and dirty. You know, girls get about 2 inches of height after their first cycle. Okay, very rough and dirty. So if a girl is getting her first cycle, let's say at 8 or 9, then that is giving her less time to grow. Mm-hmm. Now, some girls who go through puberty early are not short ever. So let's say they're on the 50th percentile of a growth curve and they're having, you know, their pubertal growth. They may stop early. So these are girls who may be very tall in fourth or fifth grade, you know, and then slow down growth, and their peers catch up to them. Some girls, however, you know, by definition are going to be short, just statistically. And then they may be starting puberty and have a lower takeoff point, if you will, okay? Mm-hmm. And they have less time to grow. So theoretically, by stopping puberty, giving them more time to grow, you're increasing their height potential. Occasionally, both in children with early puberty as well as normal timing of puberty, in whom growth hormone is considered to give more time to grow, to add more height, stopping puberty is also considered to give more time to grow.
So the two together
can be used, but growth hormone is not a treatment for early puberty, and stopping puberty is not a sole treatment for short stature. In children with early puberty, if you look at the data, girls who are treated and have signs of puberty before the age of 6, and you do treat and slow puberty down or stop puberty, you do increase their final height. I think girls who are over 6, it's not clear that you're increasing their final height by only stopping puberty. And certainly girls over 8 or 9, you're probably not adding height by only stopping puberty.
So then you would give...
You may give both together, yes.
Going back to something that you said earlier, you qualified a statistic by saying Caucasian girls.
Right.
Is there a difference between Caucasian girls and, let's say, African-American girls?
Right. So, you know, it's always been taught, I learned it as a fellow and residents learn it, that, you know, black girls go into puberty earlier than white girls do. Okay. And that's always been something that's been recognized. When this study was done in the mid-90s, it sort of quantified that and showed that it wasn't unusual to see the first signs of early puberty up to 1 to 2 years earlier in black girls than in white girls. And I think it basically put into play something that had always been talked about and always been recognized. Why that occurs isn't exactly clear, but there are racial differences in many things, in, you know, body hair and heights, etc. So it's not surprising that you're seeing this difference. It also would mean that perhaps you would be more concerned based on the child's background, their family history, and their race, you know, on what you were seeing. So if you saw perhaps a six-year-old, Caucasian girl, who was having signs of puberty, you may think more about it than a seven-year-old, Black girl.
Mm-hmm. Because it's more possibility. Because
it's less unusual,
less
right?
Unusual. What other factors are there? It sounds as though over the last, say, 50 years, the age of first menstruation has only gone down by about 6 months.
About 3 to 6 months.
Three to six months. What other factors might be responsible for that?
Well, if you look back historically over a couple hundred years, the most important factors that have led to a moving down in the time of puberty are, nutrition and healthcare and basically sanitation and antibiotics. So if you look at pre-World War II Europe versus post-World War II Europe, you would see a difference. Just like if you looked at, the mid-1800s versus the mid-1900s, you would see a difference. One of the things that is definitely that is likely leading to earlier puberty is obesity. When children are heavier, they tend to push their maturity indexes, if you will, ahead a little bit, and they may be much more likely to have early puberty because of obesity. And that's something that's likely related.
Does that have anything to do with the fat it's relationship not, to hormones?
So fatty tissue can make estrogen. It's not clear that that's the sole reason that that's occurring in heavier kids, but certainly it's one of the theories. And that, like I said, that's probably the biggest reason that we're seeing some changes, other than just natural changes over time, just genetically, evolutionarily, if you will. Other concerns that have been raised, and it's not clear, is whether there's environmental impacts. Whether there's anything in a class of chemicals that are known as endocrine disruptors that are presence in many things, or presence in plastics and in other chemicals. It's not clear that those are causing early puberty. It's a question that's been raised. Probably not in the United States food chain, but certainly in some food chains around the world. The sex steroid treatment of livestock, specifically estrogen treatment of beef cattle and of poultry, as that's gotten into the food chain, there have been many epidemics of early puberty based on certain issues with some foods. But again, that's not apparently an issue in the U.S.
We've heard about the milk. Would that be an example of that?
Well, dairy cattle is treated with a bovine growth hormone to increase milk production. And that in and of itself should not cause issues with puberty. And even if it's in milk, and if it were ingested, it would be broken down by the stomach, because growth hormone and hormones like that cannot be taken orally. There's been expert panels that have been convened to look at the issue of BST, of bovine growth hormone, and milk and safety, and it's felt to be safe.
Mm-hmm.
And my kids drink whatever my wife buys, with or without BST.
We don't even know which has, do we?
You know if it doesn't.
Oh, because it says...
It's labeled, BST free.
Uh-huh. You might get it at a health food store then?
You can get it at Trader Joe's.
Oh, you can?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I wanted to ask you about, I know that you're a physician and not a sociologist, a social psychologist, but in your experience, just in your clinical practice, is there a relationship between early puberty and early expressions of sexuality, for instance? And what would be the impact on the child and on the family?
Okay. So I think, like anything else affecting a child, it depends on their environment they grow up in, and what their interaction with their parents and their peers and caregivers and teachers and their social structure is. Certainly, there are textbook pictures of 6 and 7 and 8 year old girls who were impregnated, usually by incest, and obviously mm-hmm. those girls had early puberty. There have been studies looking at outcomes of these girls, and I think they're varied. It probably increases the risk, but I think, again, it depends on the environment in which they're raised. As I mentioned earlier, if you've got a girl whose mom, and aunts and cousins went through the same, early development and were comfortable with it and talked about it, then as they would talk about sexuality when they were 12 or 14, then maybe sort of turning the clock back a little bit. I think if you have a child who doesn't have that support system in place, it may increase the risk. The literature points to, perhaps a little bit more problems with adjustment and depression, and, medically, I guess, what could be termed early sexual debut, but it doesn't have to be the rule by any means.
But sometimes for girls, say early development and even dramatic development, let's say, of the breasts, causes attention, whether wanted or unwanted, but mostly unwanted, so that no matter how they're brought up and no matter what their relationship to the family, the boys in the class make it very clear what they think of them and maybe call them names.
Sure.
and other things, so that they may be put in their place regardless of how they feel about themselves.
Sure. They can certainly...
It's social.
Right. Elementary and middle school and older boys are not always bright in how they interact with their peers and their boys,
mm-hmm.
Speaking as the father of two. That certainly it may make girls feel uncomfortable. Obviously, you want boys' behavior to be appropriate. You want girls' behavior to be appropriate and their interactions to be appropriate. And that, again, if the girls are feeling uncomfortable, even older than 8 or 9, because they're being singled out or looked at differently, then it may be a reason to talk about, treating the girls just to, give them a bridge to some maturity, both of themselves as well as their peers.
Do you recommend either psychological or other forms of counseling for either the child or for her parents?
Not as a rule. I think, take it case by case. If the kids are obviously uncomfortable or having some issues with, self-image or taunting, then, we'll have them speak to somebody. But again, usually in the office, the fact that the conversation has been started in a safe place, it may make, the moms feel a little bit more comfortable, with a third person in the room. Whether it's a male or female physician, it generally doesn't matter. And so the kids get permission to talk about their feelings in that sense.
The mother usually comes into the examining room with the child.
Oh, absolutely.
So that it's not really safe for a child who isn't talking to the mother then. The child would be talking to you.
Well, but the conversation is started, and hopefully by the fact that, a physician, a nurse, whomever is starting the conversation, the kids realize it's okay to talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
Just like with any other conversation that you would have in the office, whether smoking or drinking or anything else.
And you have all of those too.
Sure. We see lots and lots of kids.
Just as an aside, obesity, is that difficult to talk about and to get change?
Oh, it's very easy to talk about. It's very difficult to change.
I
mean, changing is changing somebody's lifestyle.
A family's lifestyle.
Very frequently a family's lifestyle. And obesity is a terrible epidemic. It's going to bankrupt Medicare. It's starting much and much younger. We're seeing, not necessarily, in Morris County or in New Jersey, but around the country there are diabetes centers where there's more type 2 diabetes than type 1. And type 2 is a obesity-related disease, and type 1 is autoimmune, so you can't.
And I understand
it.
That this is off topic,
okay.
But I understand that children are getting type 2 diabetes.
Absolutely.
Now.
Yeah.
Is that what you meant?
That's what I meant. Yeah.
Oh,
because
okay.
of the obesity, if you look at Texas and California and some inner-city places, seeing a lot of type 2. I mean, we're still 90-95% type 1 in our center, but we're seeing some more type 2 as well.
It's frightening. What would be your recommendation, let's say, I think you've already talked about this, but is there anything else that parents need to know in terms of maybe preparing their children? There are parents who are kind of clueless about how soon the talk has to take place.
Obviously a lot goes to parenting style and parents' comfort level. Realizing that, two or three axillary hair under your arms, some body odor or a couple of pubic hair doesn't mean that a girl is going to have, her period tomorrow. Or even the fact if she has a little bit of a breast bud doesn't mean things are moving rapidly. But I think it's a time where kids can start talking about, things with their parents. Kids in some ways have a lot more knowledge than we give them credit for They read a lot, they see a lot, and you know, the internet is a good and a dangerous place.
Mm-hmm.
And I think just, you know, bringing the subject up, certainly hopefully kids are having annual visits with the pediatrician and they're being examined, including for pubertal status. And that's a time where the pediatrician could explain what they're looking for, where the parents can ask, and then talk about the normal timing and tempo of puberty at that point as well.
Yeah, that would be very, very helpful that you bring up the subject.
True.
Would be very helpful to a lot of parents, I'm sure. How about boys? Are boys experiencing puberty earlier?
It's not clear. The types of studies that have been relatively informative in girls, and in fact, that you have a marker in girls, and you know, you can quantify, or you know, when breast development occurs, not quantify, but you can time it. You could certainly time when menses occurs. In boys, you're actually looking for a change in the size of their testes, and that's obviously a lot harder to mark. It's probably occurring a little bit earlier in some boys, although obesity may have the opposite effect in boys. Certainly some boys with obesity wind up with delayed puberty.
Really?
And as a rule, you know, early or early normal puberty in girls and late or late normal puberty in boys is what's common. So we very frequently see boys with delayed puberty.
What would that mean in terms of
they're just late bloomers. After 14, having first signs of puberty after 14. You know, those
so
guys.
So normal is?
Boys starting between 9 and 14.
Mm-hmm.
Girls starting between 8 and 13.
I see.
Is still, you know, pretty much normal. The textbooks dither around the 8, as we talked about with girls. But again, boys, you may not know they've been in puberty for a while, as you're not going to have growth spurts and other outward signs for about a year after you see some of the changes that are starting, you know, in the genital area.
Is it kind of more gradual then? You don't notice it because it's...
Great. You don't see
so
it.
So that a voice changing, for instance...
Voice changing is going to be mid-pubertal. So once a boy's been in puberty for about a year and a half is when you're going to start seeing those changes.
And is there an effect on their height?
Again, yes, if kids go through puberty very early, their ultimate height may be attenuated. They may not grow quite as long and therefore as high, as tall as they were going to be.
So that would be a matter of concern, let's say, for the parents.
It is, yeah. It's a frequent reason why we see children, just to make sure they're growing the way they're supposed to be growing and are going to be of what the parents consider to be an appropriate height.
This is fascinating. You know, our time has flown. And I'm wondering, is there some piece of this that I haven't asked that I really should have in terms of informing parents and children?
I think we've covered it. I think just taking everything with perspective, putting it, you know, in context and not being overly concerned, realizing that these children, their pediatricians, their school nurses even, are going to be good sources of information to start conversations if there are concerns. And it should certainly never be a taboo that people are unwilling to speak about, because the last thing you want to do is to not acknowledge and therefore ignore something, you know, that may be of a real medical concern, but certainly of a psychological concern to the kids who it's affecting.
And it may be that there are parents who feel that would stimulate them sexually, so we shouldn't talk about it.
Right. Well, you know, TV watching does not stimulate early puberty, even Britney Spears.
Right. Okay. Well, thank you so much.